God creates a soul, it's an eternal investment. And so the moment he creates a soul, he must contemplate that soul for the rest of eternity. Because it never ends, not even with life. It goes on after life ends here on earth. And so even if that soul is in hell, he must contemplate that soul. The lines are still in the pool. There's a point where I read a James Michener book called Chesapeake. And this book encouraged me to take a journey back in August with three teenagers. And the plan was this, that we would go down to Chesapeake Bay all the way to the Cape Charles, Virginia, and then around the outside and back up north to the C&D Canal and go across right back where we started. And so I did all the research I possibly could. I looked at the maps, I looked at the tide levels, the inlets, I looked at marinas, everything else, and I planned the campgrounds and the marinas where the boat would be moored every day. And so I did all the research and was ready to take this trip. And as we packed for this trip, I packed six bottles of Corona and put two limes in the pool. So the plan was, every night we stop at a campground, once we're settled, we gather around the fire, crack that open, put in a lime, and say, job well done, we made it, good work. The limes are still in the pool. You know, as we're taking off and we're embarking, it's at 4 o'clock on a Sunday. And we tried to make the boat as light as we could, but we had to pack food and supplies for the whole week. We had to pack camping gear and camp items and drinks, etc. And so we're going along, and when you're in a boat, you want a plane, which means you get above the surface of the water and kind of skim across it so that it's less drag. And we were kind of lumbering through it like a snowplow. So we emptied out the freshwater tank, 25 gallons. It had a toilet, a sink, and everything on board there. So we emptied that out, trying to make the boat as light as we could, and it was still just lumbering along. I think we averaged about 12 miles per hour. Now, our first campground was supposed to be about 2 hours away. But going, you know, the speed we were, and the wind was against us, and the current, you know, the swells were pretty big. It was like being on a treadmill the wrong way. Weren't making any ground. And then off in the distance, we saw the black clouds coming in. There was a storm coming up from the south, going southwest, and we were trying to avoid it. We were hugging along the eastern shore, but it was coming faster, and the wind coming more, it was slowing us down, so we were at 8 miles per hour, fluctuated between 7 and 8 miles per hour. Now, I had read online somewhere before we left, that in order to make the boat lighter, don't fill up the gas tank. Put in only as much gas as you need to get to your destination, maybe a little more. And I thought this was good advice. So as we were getting closer to the campground and dusk was coming, it was getting darker, and those clouds were coming in, and it now began thundering and lightning, I looked at the gas gauge and saw that the needle was definitively pointed to empty. We were running out of gas, and we weren't going to make it campsite. And we can see off in the distance, the sky had opened and the rain was coming down. And so I began to pray. And my prayer was essentially like, you know, Lord, when you calmed the storm and the sea when the apostles were there, could you do that again, please? And then when it didn't happen, I thought, I need to leverage something. So I said, Lord, what if a priest drowns? I mean, the teenagers can handle themselves, but what about if I'm gone? What are you going to do, you know? So if for no other reason, save me for a utilitarian reason, that you need me in your church when I come back. We're getting closer and closer to Rock Hall, the lightning flashing, the thunder. The kids thought this was awesome. We're in the middle of this storm, and all I could think of was, sit right back and you'll hear a tale. A tale of a faithful trip. Not a faithful trip, but a faithful trip. We got into Rock Hall, into the harbor area, and it was so dark we couldn't see anything. And now the rain was pouring down. So in an effort to illuminate things, I got on the bow of the boat with a spotlight. And so I'm trying to spot where we're going when all of a sudden my nephew turns hard to port, and I almost slid right off the bow into the water. And so as I turn around as calmly as I can to scream at him to find out why he did this, I saw exactly what it was. It was a rock jetty that had come out of the water. And it wasn't marked. There wasn't a buoy or anything on it. That's the first time we were saved. We get into Rockfall Harbor and we're looking for a gas station so we can fill up. Everywhere is closed. They just finished their Pirates and Wenches weekend at Rock Hall. So the revelers were kind of going back to their ships. It looked like they had sea legs, but they weren't on the sea, if you know what I mean. And so as I asked them one after another, where's the gas station, where they had no time for that. It was now approaching 9 o'clock and the winds were picking up. The rain was starting to fall. And so I headed back, we put on the fenders, we tied up the boat, and then we went into the cabin to weather the storm. And it wasn't a few moments in the cabin until the ceiling started leaking. And so we grabbed as many pots or Tupperware containers as we could, and we're holding pots, trying to keep dry. We're all soaking wet, either from humidity or from rain, and it is just miserable. Now, we got rocked around probably for the better part of an hour. We knew we were not going to make it to the campground. We were going to have to sleep here. What's more is, we didn't pay for this dockage. So at any point, we could be kicked out and we'd have to anchor somewhere out there. But right now, the water was like glass. The moon was out, the sky was clear. Nobody could sleep because there was nowhere to sleep. My nephew came out with me, and we had probably one of the best talks we've ever had. He told me stuff he hasn't told anyone. And then he finally decided, I'm going to go out on the bow and fall asleep. And that's what he did. And we heard sirens and we heard radios all night, police going in and out. Didn't quite know what was happening. In the morning, well, I'm embarrassed to admit this, but since we didn't pay for dockage, we had to scoot out of there before we did. But I figured since we paid for the campground, we didn't get to stay there, kind of equal out in the long run. So we pulled up, we slipped our cables, and we left there. And we found the first gas station, and the man was kind of teary-eyed. He looked like he was shaken. And when asking about getting gas, he said that one of their employees had died last night in the storm. Was out, actually out on a boat trying to rescue someone else, and they had sank. The boat sank. And the police boats and fire boats were out all night looking for the body. That's what they were doing. So the day started out really kind of somber. We did go to the gas station, and we only had a 2-hour trip, so it was a short trip to the next destination. So I put in 3/4 of a tank. I thought that should be enough this time. We made our way out, and the sky was blue and clear, beautiful day. We still weren't planing, though. We're still dragging through the water. And we still had the wind against us, that southern wind coming. So we're going a little slower than usual. Now, something about the Chesapeake is you can see water straight across. In some places, you can't see land. I mean, it is huge. And when you look out, we can see that it's 10 miles now to get to our destination. We're free and clear. But in some places in the Chesapeake, there's a small stretch of land, a little spit that will come out, and it may come out 5 miles. So you can't just cut straight across that. You have to go 5 miles out and around it and 5 miles in, which turned our 10 miles into a possible 20. So I talked to my nephew and he said, 5 miles back, we passed the marina. Do you want to go back and get gas? Why would we get gas? It's only 10 miles to our destination. So we did. And at one point, he said, we have a quarter tank left. Well, now it's too late to go back. And so I prayed once again. And I made all kinds of deals with God this whole time. And I prayed, Lord, just get them to the campground. There, you know, last night was horrible, and I don't even want to go on this trip anymore, and I'm afraid there's going to be a rebellion and a mutiny. And so we get at a point where almost the whole way around that little stretch, probably 8 miles now away from our campground, and it runs out of gas. We had a little dinghy there, like an inflatable kayak we used as a dinghy. And so before they threw me overboard, I decided to go ahead and get in the boat. And I was going to row the 2 miles to shore. trip going to this campground, we had passed the one we were originally supposed to stay at. And there is no place to dock a boat there. So during that storm, I would have been double anchored out there and probably would have capsized. That was the second time we got saved. So now we're out there 2 miles offshore. I start paddling toward the shore with the only thing that we could carry gasoline in, which was 2 5-gallon spring water containers that we had brought for our drinking water. So I put them in the back. I kayak the 2 miles to shore. And there's one man fishing out on a jetty. And I thought, thank goodness, our Savior. And I approach him and I explain what's going on. And he said, no hable inglés. So I started speaking Spanish to him. And he laughed. I thought, oh man, I got caught here, you know. And so he explained what he was doing there. And he said he would drive me 10 miles to town to get gas. And so he did. He drove me 10 miles. I filled up the 2 5-gallon containers. We came back. I got in the kayak, pushed them toward the back, braced them in with my back, and began to row back toward the boat. And I rowed out toward the boat, and there were the kids. They were fishing because they were hungry. That's what they said. We're fishing because we're hungry. So in any case, we hadn't put gas in the boat. All we had was an orange juice container. We cut off the bottom, made a funnel out of it, hooked the little tube up, and we ran gasoline into the gas tank. 10 gallons. And we tried to start that engine for the longest time, and nothing would happen. I mean, it wasn't prime. There was nothing in the carburetor. It wasn't going to work. So I called the place where we were going to stay that night, and I said, can you tow us? Is there anyone who can tow us? Because now, off in the distance, we saw dark blue clouds coming in. There was another storm coming up from the south. And we could see the rain coming down. And so we were scared. The last thing you want to do is be in a disabled boat 2 miles offshore in a storm. So finally, the lady found someone to tow us. They came. The good old boy showed up. They put their ropes on the boat, and they started towing us. And my nephew said to me, how much is this going to cost? And I said, $700. And he said, cut the rope! I didn't want to be stranded out here another night. And they were racing against time because the storm was coming in. They were only going about 10 miles per hour because they were pulling us. We finally made it to the camp area. We brought the boat in, and the good old boys took out their beers and started drinking and wanted to talk shop. Meanwhile, I'm thinking there's a storm coming. I got two of them, go set up the tent, get everything dry in so that at least we have a dry place to stay. Because for 3 days we've been wet all the time, either from humidity or rain. We've just been soaking. It was horrible. And so the good old boys were working on the boat. They got it started. They wanted to make sure it was fixed, and they took off. We're walking out to the campsite, which is a half a mile from the marina area. So every time we had to go to the showers or whatever, it was half a mile. So we get there, they're all dry, they're in the tents, they head out to the showers. I decide that I'm going to make supper for us, because it's about 8 o'clock now at night. And so I take out the Coleman stove, I have the pots and the food and everything getting ready, and I don't have a match or a lighter or anything. So I walk all the way back to the boat just to get a lighter. I'm on my way back, the sky opens up, and I'm just soaked, totally soaked. But I open an umbrella, and I'm there, and I'm cooking. Everyone just ate voraciously and went to bed. And it thundered, lightning all night. It was raining and everything else. I got up early in the morning, as I'm customary to do, and I celebrated Mass. Very begrudgingly, with gritted teeth. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings that you have showered on us. Well, that's not blessings. It was rain and humidity, hunger, and all these other things. And I started making a breakfast buffet. I felt so bad for these kids. I told them the night before, you need to have a meeting and discuss whether we're going to keep on this trip or whether we're going to turn back tomorrow. Because it's a disaster. I didn't expect to spend $700 on towing. I didn't expect that the current would always be against us or the wind or anything else. And so I started cooking the bacon and the sausage and potatoes and all this stuff. I was going to mix it all together into this casserole. And the girl who came along, her family has chickens. So she brought those eggs because you don't have to refrigerate them. And so I finished everything, and then I cracked the first egg to put it in, and the stuff came out like water. I thought, oh, man. And then the next one came out like water. Then the next one came out okay. The one after that is okay. So they all smell the food cooking. They come out of the tent, and I say to the girl, are these okay? Because it kind of came out like water, and I've never seen that before. Oh, yeah, they're fine. They do that all the time. Okay. So I explained to the kids, here's what happened with the eggs. You can eat this if you want to. I'm not eating it. Because if all of us are sick, it's going to be very bad. And so they all ate the egg thing. I had a granola bar. And they didn't get sick. But we started our journey once again. We decided that we're going to finish it. We wanted to go all the way to Virginia at the very least. And I'll tell you, if that tank hit a half a tank, we'd pull over every marina we found. We weren't taking any chances. The whole way down. The wind was against us once again the whole day. We averaged about 10 miles per hour. And every now and then we hit these 5-foot swells and you're just chopping in the water. You're not going anywhere. It was supposed to take 4 hours. It took us 8. But we were determined to get to Virginia because there we were actually going to stay in a hotel and have hot showers and beds and stuff like that. And we did. We arrived in Virginia. We went under the bridge and there was great celebration. It was still light outside. And we got to the hotel and they hit the showers right away. So I went to a Chinese restaurant downtown and I just said, we'll take this and this and this and this and this. And they put it in a box and we brought it back to the room and I didn't have any utensils. And you know what? It didn't matter. It was like piranha. They came in and they just were scooping stuff and shoving it in their mouth and just washing it down. And the limes were still in the cooler. And the cooler was on the boat. And I was at the hotel. So I went and got a bottle of bourbon. Because I thought I deserved that. And we called someone and said, can you come down here? They gave us one day of freedom. We just relaxed, and the next day they would come all the way down with the trailer. We would trailer the boat, and then we would head back. And throughout this whole adventure, there was one rule: no complaining. And throughout the trip, only one person complained all the time. And I'm not going to tell you who it was. Because I know you'll judge me. But these kids kept saying the same five words over and over again. And I don't know whether it was uplifting or whether it was giving me more and more post-traumatic stress. They said, when we do this again. We ain't never doing this again. You know, these Maccabeans who went to their death first reading didn't go to their death because they were afraid of hell. They didn't go to their death because they were afraid of God. They went to their death out of a love for God. Out of a love for God. A God of the living and the dead. And this God that we have knows what he's doing. So often I question many times during that trip. But you know, all of us walked away from it without a scratch. Not even so much as a scratch. No dehydration, no seasickness, no anything. Despite all those things that happened, we were saved. God knew what he was doing. And there has to be a point in our life where we stop following the commandments or going to Mass or praying because we're afraid of going to hell. And we do these things out of a love for the beloved. We do these things out of a love for the one who knows what he's doing. God knows what he's doing. The question is, do we?
Just sit right back and you'll hear a tale of a fateful trip that started from this tropic port aboard this tiny ship. The mate was a mighty sailing man, skipper brave and sure. Five passengers set sail that day for a three-hour tour. The weather started getting rough, the tiny ship was tossed. If not for
or the courage of a fearless crew, the middle would be lost. The middle would be lost. The ship set round on the shore of this uncharted desert isle, with Gilligan, the skipper too, a millionaire and his wife, a movie star, the professor and Mary Ann, here on Gilligan's Isle. So this is the tale of our castaways, they're here for a long, long time. They'll have to make the best of things, it's an uphill climb. But first mate and his skipper too will do their very best to make the others comfortable in the tropic island nest.
No phone,
no lights,
no motor car, not a single luxury. Like Robinson Crusoe, it's primitive as can be. So join us here each week, my friends, you're sure to get a smile from seven stranded castaways here on Gilligan's Isle.
Something about a boat sitting on the sea, out there in the wind, floating on the free. Jig around the world, bring you back home. Gives a man hope. Something about a boat. Something about an old guitar and the way it still sings after all the smoky bars and the broken strings. Played a million songs, broke a lot of hearts, made some people stars. Something about an old guitar. Ain't it crazy how something seems like nothing at all? Take a big old room, make it seem so small. A whole lot of something out of nothing at all. Something about your dog sitting by your side. If you had a bad day, she ain't gonna run and hide. Just a wagging that tail, grinning that grin. Something about my dog makes her my best friend. Ain't it crazy how something seems like nothing at all? Take a big old room, make it seem so small. Seeing windows where there are walls makes a whole lot of something out of nothing at all. Makes a whole lot of something out of nothing at all. Something about a dog, something about an old guitar, something about a boat gives a man hope.
That's the moment
thank the Lord. And I said to myself, sit down, you're rocking the boat. Said to myself, sit down, you're rocking the boat. And the devil will drag you under, with a soul's ahead.
Special place we love that just a few folks know. There's no signing up, no monthly dues. Take your Johnson, your Mercury, or your Evinrude and fire it up. Beat us out at Party Cove. Come on in, the water's fine. Just idle on over and toss us a line. Fast tractors, bay liners, and a party barge strung together like a floating trailer park. Anchored out and getting loud all summer long. Side to side, there's five houseboat front porches, astroturf lawn chairs and tiki torches. Regular Joes rocking the boat, that's us, the Redneck Yacht Club. His flip-flops and a tank top tan. He popped his first top at 10 a.m. That's Bob. He's our president. We're checking out the girls on the upper deck, rubbing in the 15 SPF. It's hot. Everybody's jumping in. Later on when the sun goes down, we'll pull out the jar and that old guitar and pass them around. Bass trackers, bay liners, and a party barge strung together like a floating trailer park. Anchored out and getting loud all summer long. Side by side there's five houseboat front porches, astroturf lawn chairs and tiki torches. Regular Joes rocking the boat, that's us, the Redneck Yacht Club. Party's over and we're all alone. We'll be making waves in a no-wake zone. Fast trackers, bay liners, and a party barge strung together like a floating trailer park. Anchored out and getting loud all summer long. Side by side there's five houseboat front porches, astroturf lawn chairs and tiki torches. Regular Joes rocking the boat, that's us, the Redneck Yacht Club. Redneck Yacht Club. Redneck Yacht Club.
Sending big waves into motion. Like like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say were wrecking balls inside my brain. I will scream loud tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life. Everybody's worried about me. In too deep, I say I'm in too deep. And it's been 2 years, I miss my home. But there's a fire burning in my bones. Still believe, yeah, I still believe. And all those things I didn't say, wrecking balls inside my brain. I was screaming.
No, I've still got a lot of fight left in me.